A light at the end of the tunnel is how Prime Minister Trudeau referred to news this week that at least one of the vaccines in the works to fight COVID-19 actually seems to work. It's early days, though, so let's find out just how bright that light is at this point. Dr. Isaac Bogoch is an infectious diseases physician at the University Health Network and a scientist based out of Toronto General Hospital and the U of T, and he joins us now from his office at TGH. Dr. B, how are you managing?
Managing okay. How about yourself?
Well, something tells me you've got a bigger to-do list than I do these days, so I'm glad to hear you're still healthy and okay.
We're all busy. I think we're all managing it the way we can.
Good enough. Tell me, the news of the week, that this thing is 90% effective, or so they've found so far, how big a deal in your eyes?
Based on the data that we have available, it looks really good. And if it even comes close to being 90% effective in preventing COVID-19, that would be a huge win. I think we also have to couch this with maybe in cautious optimism. This was a press release. We don't have all the data. We have some snippets of data that the company released. Normally, we'd like to pore over the data and make our own opinions about how effective and how safe it is. But, you know, with the snippets of data that were available, it looks really good. And at least it looks like we're on the right track to developing a successful vaccine.
But to be clear, you have not been able to do the deep dive that you would like to do on what's come out so far?
No, I mean, quite frankly, I've got access to the same thing that everyone else does, which is, you know, we have some details. We know, you know, they enrolled over 43,000 people. We know half got the vaccine and half got the placebo. We know that there were 94 events. They really want to keep this going until they have 164 events. Events, of course, is a case of COVID-19. We're told that the people in the vaccine group had significant protection against COVID-19 and that of all those 94 cases, about 90% of the people that got COVID-19 were in the placebo group. So at face value, that looks very, very promising. However, you know, they got to finish the trial. We've got to see the data. We've got to look at the efficacy of the vaccine. We've got to look at the safety profile of the vaccine. And then I think we can have more meaningful conversations. But still, at the end of the day, I mean, based on what we have available to us, looks really good to me. And quite frankly, I think there really is room for cautious optimism. This might be one of the vaccines that really goes through to completion. And this might be one of the vaccines that's rolled out on a population level.
Just an odd, curious question. What happens to the 10% who don't clear it?
Yeah, great point. So we don't really know. And I think there's a ton of unanswered questions. So one of them is, you know, obviously, what is the true efficacy and safety of the vaccine? But also, you know, if you got the vaccine and got COVID-19, does it mitigate how sick you are? Are you still able to transmit the infection as readily as if you didn't get the vaccine? Like, there's a lot of questions that remain unanswered, and I think we'll have more of those answers as time goes on. But for the snippet of information that we had available, looks good for now, but of course it just whets our appetite. Like, it's like the teaser for a movie. It's not really the full thing, although it's a good teaser.
Well, let's keep talking about the trailer for this movie then. One of the things that has come up, and one of the things I guess I have learned through the course of this, is that it's tricky to store all this stuff. And apparently it needs to be stored and transported at minus 80 degrees, which sounds very, 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 very cold. Is that typical for a vaccine?
No, it certainly isn't. There's a couple of vaccines, the mRNA vaccines, that appear to really require some deep, deep freezing temperatures and deep freezers to do this. So it isn't typical. And of course, that requires significant infrastructure to do. It's not everyone has a minus 80 freezer in their basement. Having said that, while there are logistical hurdles, if this vaccine makes it through, and if this vaccine is approved, and if it's going to be rolled out nationwide, you know, I think, quite frankly, the rate limiting step is producing a vaccine for an infection that we didn't even know existed 11 months ago, not keeping the vaccine cold. We do have minus 80 degree freezers. We do have the capacity to, you know, get this vaccine into people's arms all over the country. But yeah, there certainly will be hurdles to doing so. The other interesting thing is, if you look at, for example, the vaccines for Ebola virus in the Democratic Republic of Congo, some of those vaccines needed to be stored at minus 80 degrees Celsius. And they found a way to do it in the DRC, which is, you know, while working in a very resource-limited setting, they're able to do this successfully. I think we'll be able to do it successfully in Canada.
In which case, how close, if this is the real deal, how close to market, how close to rolling out might this actually be?
Okay, please don't hold me to anything here. This is pure speculation. But it wouldn't be inconceivable to have vaccine programs roll out, you know, sometime in early 2021, maybe in the first quarter of 2021. Like, at the end of the day, the next steps are they're going to basically share their data with various government bodies, for example, Health Canada here at home, the FDA in the United States, and other bodies around the world. And those independent government bodies are really going to be evaluating the data. They're really going to look at the side effect profile, you know, the safety profile, the efficacy. They're going to pore over all that data, and they're going to determine if, you know, this is the real deal, and if this should be approved, or perhaps it might not be. And if it is approved, I think we can start to see vaccine rollout shortly after. We already have seen the federal government take steps to implement vaccine programs nationwide. So hopefully everyone gets what they need to get in order before a vaccine is approved. So when the time comes and a vaccine is approved, we can just roll out these programs nationwide.
This is admittedly a bit of a bizarre question, but humor me for a second here, okay? We have heard from various circles in the United States that some people who are Donald Trump supporters think that the news of this vaccine and its potential was held back by the big pharmaceutical companies and others involved in an attempt to harm the Trump campaign. Now, I'm not asking you whether you have any knowledge about that. There's no reason why you would have knowledge about that. But you do know the pharmaceutical industry, and I'm wondering if you have any examples you can look at which might suggest that there would be a political agenda to anything they roll out or don't roll out. Not necessarily specific to this election campaign, but ever.
So nothing comes to mind, but there are certainly smarter people who can answer that question better. What's interesting is we know in the United States they have a program called Operation Warp Speed, where basically they provide funding and support and resources to various companies that are developing a vaccine. Pfizer was not a part of that. So Pfizer had nothing to do with Operation Warp Speed. They did not take any funding. They were functioning independently. So that's kind of interesting because they're actually functioning at an arm's length from the government with this. So but in all fairness, I have no idea what motivated them to release the data when they did. Perhaps this is just when they had the data available and they're functioning independently. But, you know, I'm sure we could find several different answers for that question, depending on who you ask.
Well, thanks for humoring me on that one anyway. Okay, let's look at this. You know, people who do what you do talk about the numbers of people in a country or in a society that need to be inoculated in order to have what they call herd immunity. In this case, what would that number be?
Interesting. There have been a few different, you know, back of the envelope calculations to determine this. The numbers usually range around 50 to 70%. Some of that might change based on how effective the vaccine actually functions. And of course, what's the appetite among the Canadian population to take this vaccine? I think it's also really important to note here that, of course, it does matter to that the number of people that do accept this vaccine here in Canada. That's an important number. But it's also important to recognize that this is a global problem, and we have over 7 billion people that should have access to this vaccine in an equitable manner. We know this is such a contagious infection, and before COVID-19, people are mobile. I mean, we've seen firsthand how you can have an infection from one corner of the planet land on any other corner of the planet in less than 24 hours. We really need a global push for vaccination, and that's why there's programs, something called COVAX, C-O-V-A-X, which is a wonderful program that's basically trying to provide equitable access to vaccines. It's with Bill and Melinda Gates, the World Health Organization, Gavi. There's several different big groups that are involved with this.
And we're in
really
it, too.
Help push
Canada's in it, too.
Vaccine.
Canada's
we
in
are.
It, too.
We certainly yeah. are. In fact, many, many countries are involved with this. So it's excellent. And while, of course, we definitely want to have vaccine uptake in Canada, and of course, yeah, we want to have around 60% 90% of the people vaccinated. Hopefully it's a lot more. We also have to think about the number of people vaccinated worldwide.
And again, tell us whether or not everybody, I mean, at some point when this comes out, I need to know who's eligible to get it, in as much as would the oldest people in society get it and the newest born babies, would they get it too?
Well, ultimately, hopefully everyone has access to this, but there certainly will be a priority group, and there's almost a triage of who's going to get this first. And we have a vaccine task force. We also have something called NACI in Canada. Don't ask me what it stands for. National Advisory something something immunizations. Of course, I don't remember it while I'm on camera. But you know, they really create guidance as to who should get the vaccine first. And basically, it boils down to people at risk of having severe outcomes and people at risk of getting this infection. So when we look at the NACI guidance, we see, you know, long-term care facilities, indigenous populations, people in congregate settings, frontline healthcare workers. Like that's sort of the flavor of people who would likely be prioritized to get this vaccine first. If Pfizer goes the distance and if Pfizer delivers what they said they'll deliver to Canada, which is 20 million doses, which is enough for 10 million people to get vaccinated, I mean, that's a lot of people. And certainly, I think a 10 million people being vaccinated can certainly cover a lot of people who are at risk of having severe illness. So congregate settings, long-term care, those over 65, frontline healthcare workers. But of course, I think it's also important to remember that Pfizer is just one of several vaccines that are in the, that are at the forefront of perhaps having a successful vaccine make it through to completion. But there's several others that aren't too far behind. We heard of AstraZeneca that are in advanced phase 3 clinical trials. We've heard of Moderna, Johnson & Johnson. Like, there's several other groups that are not too far behind. So it's very exciting times on the vaccine front.
And just to be clear, you say 10 million people could get covered by 20 million doses because you've got to get two shots per person. But that presumably means, given the hierarchy that you just laid out, that presumably means that we're many, many, many months down the road before the average Canadian would be eligible for a shot. Is that fair to say?
I think that's fair to say. I think that's very fair to say. And I think it's also fair to say that while this, we have, based on the contract that we see available to us, we have access to 20 million doses for 10 million people. There's also the opportunity to purchase more from Pfizer if this is approved by Health Canada. But it's clear that we'll likely have several vaccines roll out through Canada. And it probably will, there will probably be many products. And we have 38 million people, and hopefully the vast majority of people will take this up, but it's not quite clear how many will. There's been various surveys and polls saying, you know, we'll have X number of people accepted and Y number of people accepted. At the end of the day, I'm not really sure how many people will accept this vaccine, but there's certainly room for several successful vaccine candidates to roll out across Canada.
Now, we've talked on this program before about how, well, I guess in the States they call it warp speed. It is warp speed with which this thing is being developed. I mean, typically it can take decades or certainly many, many years for a vaccine to be developed. Do you think people should have any cause for concern that this is coming out so quickly?
No, I really don't, because quite frankly, it doesn't appear that any corners were being cut. They've really harnessed pre-existing technology that's been around for, you know, the last, well, several decades to create vaccines and essentially just tweak them so that they could make COVID-19 vaccines. So I don't think that any group that's in an advanced stage of vaccine development has started really from scratch. They hit the ground running with the pre-existing vaccine technology that has been used for decades. And in addition to that, they've also gone through the requisite phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3 clinical trials with the data safety monitoring boards that we would see and, you know, outside of COVID-19 vaccine or drug trials. So the process is sound. I think it's important also that there's no political pressure or extraneous pressure on independent government bodies to evaluate the safety and efficacy of these vaccines when they're making the decision to roll these out nationwide. But, you know, this is the same process. The other important point, too, is studying these vaccines doesn't end after they roll out throughout a community, right? There's still what's called post-marketing surveillance. Sometimes it's also referred to as a phase 4 clinical trial. But essentially, tracking the safety and the effectiveness of these vaccines still is an ongoing process after these are rolled out. And you know what? It has happened in the past where a drug is rolled out or a vaccine is rolled out. And, you know, in these phase three clinical trials, you're enrolling, you know, 20, 30, 40,000 people. But obviously, that's a lot different than giving a drug or a vaccine to millions and millions of people. And sometimes it takes delivering a vaccine or a drug to millions and millions of people to see some very rare side effects. And, there have been cases of drugs or vaccines that have been pulled long after they've been rolled out to a population.
Okay, just to answer the one question you asked me during the course of this, National Advisory Committee on Immunization, NACI. There you go.
So it's embarrassing that I didn't know that and it wasn't able to roll off of my tongue. I use the NACI acronym about 5,000 times a day, but it's not every second of the day where I actually have to think about what each letter stands for. So apologies and a bit of embarrassment on my side.
No need for apologies, no need for embarrassment. That's what we're here for. Anyway, Dr. Bogoch, it's awfully good of you to spend some time with us on TVO tonight, as you so often do. Thanks so much and stay safe.
My pleasure. Have a great evening.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario. CPA Ontario is a regulator, an educator, a thought leader, and an advocate. We protect the public. We advance our profession. We guide our CPAs. We are CPA Ontario. And by viewers like you. Thank you.